Schaaf is in his third year as the head coach at Florida. He leads his Gators into Ben Hill Griffin Stadium. Butch Jones is in his first season as head coach at Tennessee. He is about to coach the Volunteers in his first SEC game. It's the Volunteers visiting Florida here in Gainesville. Formidable here in the swamp. 1-1 this season. Their loss was on the road. The Tennessee Volunteers started off 2-0 under head coach Butch Jones, but they were shellacked at Oregon last week. We welcome you to the Home Depot SEC on CBS this afternoon. The Volunteers of Tennessee against the Gators of Florida. Good afternoon, everybody. Vern Lundquist along with Gary Danielson. Great to have you with us today. This once was one of the great rivalries in the SEC. It loses a little luster when you understand that Florida has won the last 8 games in the series. And for the Volunteers, they're trying to shake the memory of a total shellacking they received at Oregon last week. They were defeated 59-14. Gary, Butch Jones said he was opening up the quarterback position a couple of hours ago. He announced that a freshman, Nate Peterman, would start in this game. Now, you were at practice on Wednesday in Knoxville. Was this a ploy of any kind?
No, it really wasn't. All Wednesday, it split the snaps, you know, and that's what they had to do. Worthy and Peterman took 50-50, and I think that was a good message to the team, that everybody's going to compete for the job, but I'm not going to make a rash decision. Now, Peterman looks a little bit more athletic to me, and I have to say, talking to the Florida coaches, they expect if Nathan Peterman runs, they may do a little bit more quarterback run from that position, but either quarterback, Vern, for Tennessee to make it, you have to depend on where the experience is. And Tennessee has it in their offensive line. They've lived with these guys in the past when they were young. Now they need to help their quarterback and their team. Tennessee today needs to take those 5 guys, rely on them, and make some plays in the running game. That's really been the story of this series.
Well, the Florida Gators come off a loss. They were defeated 2 weeks ago in Miami, 21-16. A game saved for the turnovers they probably should have won. And those turnovers were in the red zone and at the hands of their quarterback, Jeff Driscoll.
Vern, I'm saying that Florida is the most underrated team in the country right now because they're good. They're really good. And when Jeff Driscoll's playing and he's on his game, Florida's going to be a tough team to beat. But in the past, it's been the problems with Jeff Driscoll that, yes, look at that athletic ability. He's got a gun for an arm. He runs a 4.5, 4.6, 40. But it's those mistakes. When you're running a ball control team with great defense, you depend on your team to manage it just a little bit at the quarterback position, and mistakes have been killing Florida.
Well, there are questions about the offense, but certainly, Gary, no questions about the Florida defense.
Absolutely not. As elite as any team in this country, and they've got stars on defense. Dominic Easley is almost unblockable at his defensive tackle position. He's not only strong, he pursues the whole game. He's just a beast out there. And in the secondary, they may have one of the most gifted playmakers in this conference. Luchez Purifoy is not only going to play in the secondary, he's going to maybe return punts, and we may even see him on offense.
Yeah, he's a little versatile, that's for sure. We will be back in the swamp. It's muggy today. The Home Depot SEC on CBS is sponsored by Kia, Chick-fil-A, Aflac, and by John Hancock. We welcome you back to the Swamp, also known as Ben Hill Griffin Stadium. It's the Home Depot SEC on CBS, the Volunteers of Tennessee against the Gators of Florida. Moments ago, Tracy Wolfson with Tennessee head coach Butch Jones.
Coach, you announced that you're going with Nate Peterman today. What does he bring that maybe Justin Worley doesn't?
You know, he's had a great week of preparation, and what a way to opportunity to present itself in this great environment against a great defense. But he's very poised, he's very calm, and he's very collected, and he can run the ball a little bit.
You mentioned this environment, so what did you say to him before his first start as he took the field?
It's like how we practice controlled chaos, just focus, snap and clear, and that's the mentality.
Appreciate it. Good luck tonight.
Thank you.
Now, last-minute words for Nathan Peterman, high school, Bartram Trail, just outside of Jacksonville. Tennessee won the toss. They've deferred, so that means Florida will get the ball. It's an even 90 degrees, a slight breeze out of the southwest. No rain in the forecast. Michael Pilardi will kick it off. Two men deep for the Gators. Solomon Patton, who has returned every kick this year, number 83. And Trey Burton over on the far side at the 10-yard line right now, number 8. 8 in a row. The last 6 wins by Florida over Tennessee by an average of 19 points per game.
Vern, I was thinking when Tracy was talking about Peterman with Butch there, should they save him for another game? And I looked down their schedule. There's no easy games on the schedule. Might as well throw him in the deep end, right?
Butch Jones said after the loss in Oregon last year, we're playing the toughest schedule in the history of college football. Just a little hyperbole. Well, Patton's going to bring it out. But 5 yards back, he should not have. Heck of a special teams tackle by Javen Reeves Maven. Here's Jeff Driscoll, 63%, 10-3 as a starting quarterback. In the last 3 losses, and that goes back to the beginning of last season, however, Driscoll has 10 turnovers in those 3 L's, including 2 interceptions and a fumble last week. Luchez Purifoy, Gary, you called this.
Yep.
He's lined up as the deep back, and he gets the toss and heads left. Number 15, good downfield block from Patton. Well, Will Muschamp told us yesterday we might use Purifoy in the backfield.
Well, and it's a message to this Tennessee defense after Oregon kind of got them out of their groove running wide and doing the snap count really quick, that we can tire you out in our own way. And remember, Brent Peace told us on Friday, Vern, that we're going to try to wear them out a little bit with our speed sweeps early in this game.
That's Burton in the tight right position. Here's Driscoll wearing a brace because of a sprained knee. Nobody open. He still got it. Drills it. Got a man there. That's Quentin Dunbar, number 1.
Yeah, I'm wondering if he stepped out first, though, or was he forced out first?
There is a flag.
That was after the play was called that Dunbar went out. I think did Driscoll take a shot?
Illegal touching.
Just a little
number
above
one,
it this time.
The offense went back out of bounds on his own, came back in and first to touch. The ball will be returned to the previous spot, second down.
And the ruling, as you heard, Dunbar went out of bounds, came back in.
And actually on that play, Tennessee did a good job manning up. That was a gimmick play, the second play of the game. They ran it in script on Thursday. They were trying to throw back to the running back on the fake. Tennessee had him covered beautifully, and Driscoll had to come out of the pocket to make a play.
Matt Jones, who missed all of training camp with a serious viral infection and said he was not himself 2 weeks ago against Miami, number 22. And let's introduce you to the Florida offense. Luchez Purifoy, having run on the first play, is back on the sidelines. Here's the remainder of that Gator offense, and they have struggled. They won over Troy, really had problems last week. Humphreys, Garcia, the key on the offensive line is John Jalapio. He missed the first two games, gets his start now, the senior. He had a torn pectoral muscle back in August. And the lineup's presented by Chick-fil-A. Four wides. Third and 10. Three down for Tennessee. Driscoll, a little pressure, heads left, chased, batted back, incomplete, fourth down. Brent Brewer, number 17, the linebacker, got a hand up and knocked the ball back.
Well, as much as they might at Florida wanted to get out of this early game by getting Jeff Driscoll kind of comfortable in the football game after his rough finish against Miami, Tennessee got a basically, you know, the one first down and then a three and out after the first down. So Tennessee answered the bell early.
Kyle Christie on the punt. He is a dandy. And the deep man for the Volunteers, Jacob Carter. He took a pop as well.
And it's funny, in this last 8 years, the special teams have been owned by Florida. And Butch Jones told us on the phone yesterday, he said, I would love to win the special teams. That is one area where we, if we have any chance in this game, can we steal it? And Christie, was a fine snap.
Yeah.
You cannot call that on the center. That's almost, you know, it might not be A, but it's A-minus snap there.
Drew Ferris was the lone snapper. And here is the redshirt freshman getting his first start. Handoff. They'll test the middle with Rajon Neal. Peterman has played this year in the three games. 6 of 12 for 40 yards. He's a redshirt freshman from Fruit Cove, Florida. That, as we said, is in the Jacksonville area. But what a place to start your career as a starter.
There's not a lot of hiding in this league.
No. Brendan Downs, the tight end, is in motion across the backfield. Here's the snap from James Stone. Oh, that one's
balls
fumbled.
Out. Yeah.
That's recovered. Dante Fowler Jr.
Holy cow.
A flag is down.
Butch Jones is saying it was offsides.
The flag back at the 16-yard line.
Boy, I don't know about that. Fowler came in there. I don't know if he was lined up offsides or not. There is a flag down, is there not?
Yes. It's on the far side of the field at the 16.
Dante Fowler just hits that full speed. Butch Jones is arguing, but it didn't look like he's going to win it.
Illegal formation. Five in the backfield. Tennessee. A penalty for five.
Absolutely.
Recovered by Florida.
And
first down.
How did we open up the game? That offensive line has to win. Well, right there, the offensive line lined up in the backfield, their tackle, and then it had to be a busted assignment because nobody touched Fowler.
Right. Well, what a start. Florida's got the ball for the second time.
Hey, Vern, let me get more accurately on this call. It was a bad formation by Tennessee. Six men in the backfield. Here was the guy that should have been on the line of scrimmage. There's one, two, three, four, five in the backfield right there. That is going to be a penalty. Did not have enough men on the line of scrimmage. The receiver, I don't know if it was six or eight. It was either Marquez North or Vincent Dallas, did not line up at the line of scrimmage, and that's what caused it. And actually, it was Pig Howard that didn't line up on the line of scrimmage. So, you know, the simplest of fundamentals, you know, it was a penalty to begin with. The offensive line really didn't do a good job there. Must have been a missed assignment. But when you get one of those turnovers, Florida's going to be tough enough to then make mistakes on top of it.
And so for the second possession, Matt Jones is split wide to the right. Shotgun formation. Stunts defensively. Four man. And that catch is made by Trey Burton. What did Butch Jones say? We're really worried about accounting for Burton on every play.
He is, and he's really a wide receiver now. He used to be kind of a slash player, tight end, H-back, but I know Tennessee's treating him as a wide receiver, and actually he practices and goes to all the meetings as a wide receiver. Brian Randolph right there, the free safety, should have been able to get a little closer on that one. He took a poor angle and never got there.
Gain of 21, nothing on this one. Well, let's introduce you to the Tennessee defense. They gave up 678 yards last week. Smith, McCullers, and Hood, there's the unquestioned leader defensively, A.J. Johnson, number 45. He's also, like Purifoy, been known to take a couple of snaps out of the wildcat position on offense. Second down, 9.
So far, though, they've stood strong against the Florida running game inside.
Play action, Driscoll, left side. Down the sidelines, this is Quentin Dunbar. Good or no? No. Cameron Sutton, number 23, defending.
This ball was slightly underthrown, but you can see that the attack right away, Brent Peace is saying, if you load the box against me and try to stop our run, we're going to have to throw the ball down the field. Dunbar needed another 8 yards of football to run to on that one to make that play.
And so third down, 9, Gators.
Yeah, second, third, and long in the game already, which is not usual for this style of offense of Will Muschamp and Brent Peace.
Again, a four-man rush, straight rush this time. That ball is caught by Patton. And let's check in with Tracy Wolfson.
Well, Gary, you were talking earlier about that fumble on Tennessee being a missed assignment. Well, Tennessee head coach getting on his new QB early, came over to sideline, said, you have to be poised. We cannot have missed calls. That's exactly what he did, guys.
Well, because Tennessee does not huddle. And what Tracy's saying right there, and Butch telling his quarterback, is we're calling plays at the line of scrimmage. You have to make the proper run check. They usually start with two plays. It's a check with me system, and the quarterback obviously did not call the right run.
Well, they'll measure for the first down. Matt Moore is our referee, as we've said, and it is goodbye, Smidgen. One more look. Patton.
Boy.
Oh, hello.
Well, the yellow line's not official.
No, it's not.
And by the way, that is reviewable, too. The spot is a reviewable play in college football.
Well, if they...
That looks about where he got, though, to me. Right.
Does it? Yeah. Okay. Driscoll, quick screen. This is Quentin Dunbar, number one. Dontavis Sapp. Here's Driscoll. 6-0 in the first six games as a starter. 4-3 in the last seven. And look at the touchdown to interception ratio. 11-1 and 7-6.
Yeah, but because of that knee that he injured in the second quarter against Miami, this will be the first time he's worn a knee brace in a game. He told us he would not have been able to play had they played a week ago without the bye. And I don't think we're going to see the, 80-yard runs by Jeff Driscoll. More of a pocket guy.
Patton being chased. Gets around the corner and introduces himself to a couple of volunteers. Brian Randolph, number 37, was in pursuit.
Well, the story of this series, Vern, I mean, this is our eighth game together doing this one, or seventh game. We've missed one, I guess. The last 8 years, the longest run by Tennessee in this series has been 20 yards, rush, 20 yards. And the story has been that Florida has been able to run the ball, Tennessee has not. And that means the turnover slid away from Tennessee, and everything because of the run game not being able to be established has tilted towards Florida.
Third down and 3. Driscoll again, no blitz. From the backside, Driscoll intercepted. And here we go down the sidelines. Devon Swafford, untouched. There are no flags. Tennessee, touchdown.
And on top of that, Driscoll is hurt.
Thank you.
Ryan Swafford was with Trey Burton the whole time. When he saw it, Driscoll got his leg pulled from behind. And once that happened, I think it was Corey Miller that got him from behind. The ball was late and disaster.
So the second turnover for the Florida Gators, Driscoll with another INT. And limping off the backup,
Tyler Murphy.
Officially called 62 yards on Swafford's interception.
And Vern, that's the first touchdown not by Tennessee offense in this series in a long, long time. It was Eric Berry's the last time anybody but Tennessee offense has scored in this series.
Michael Pilardi with the extra point, which is up and good.
It's Corey Miller coming from behind to make this tackle. Lets it go, and then right away he singles the bench and said, remember, no contact the last 2 weeks. And he singles, I'm in trouble.
Marlon Walls also at the foot of Jeff Driscoll.
Welcome back to Florida. We saw Jeff Driscoll go down after that last interception. He came over to the sideline. It is his right ankle. As you can see right now, he is on crutches. He tried to walk on it without those crutches and pulled back and was like, oh, 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 and had to get right onto the training table. They're going to take him in the room. They do not give any injury information here at Florida, but if I do get anything, I will certainly pass it along.
Thank you, Trace. Well, he's concerned about the left knee.
Yeah, we all thought that was it.
Yep.
And then we looked at it, got rolled up from the ankle from behind.
Lucius Purifoy is the deep man on the return. And that's 8 yards back, and he'll take a knee. And another look at the injury to the right ankle of the starting quarterback of the University of Florida.
And as we, through the commercial, we found, as Vern, you said, it was Marlon Walls, number 58, that got him. Fell on his right ankle. And, you know, this quarterback position does not have a lot of depth around here either. And it's, now we're going to find out, you know, just what happens to a very proud team that wants to control the football. And it's going to be Tyler Murphy,
who has not taken a snap in the first two games this year. He's a red shirt sophomore, junior, I beg your pardon, Tyler Murphy. Well, if you tuned in late, I bet you didn't think you'd be watching two quarterbacks named Tyler Murphy for the Florida Gators. Here's the pitch back, and nothing there. That was Mack Brown, and the quarterback for Tennessee, as you've heard, is Nathan Peterman. Weathersfield, Connecticut. He's never attempted a pass. That's a loss of 2, second down 12. Mack Brown still in. Matt Jones ineffective in the first two series. A.J. Johnson up high, number 45. Well, you watched the Gator practice. Any thoughts about
it? Yeah, a Thursday practice, you don't get to see a lot, okay? And Driscoll took most of the reps. I mean, he's a college quarterback, but let me say this. Because Driscoll was hurt the week prior, I'm sure Murphy got a lot of snaps in that bye week to get a lot of extra work ready for this game. So if you're ever going to get an opportunity to play, it might be the week that you get the extra week off and you're the only quarterback taking snaps.
Four wides, third down 6. This is Burton coming to the right side. Semi rollout by Murphy. Now it's a full scamper, and he throws back across the body, and he has completed his first pass as a Gator. It goes into the hands of Quinton Dunbar. And there's a flag down.
Well, he escapes, gets outside, and does what you have to do.
Offside, 50, defense, penalty decline, First down.
And remember, one of the reasons that Florida is a little short at quarterback is Jacoby Brissett. Remember, who was in the running for the starting job a year ago, which Jeff Driskel transferred. That's why Tyler Murphy is the backup now.
And the 13th quarterback is Skyler Morningwig. He's not even listed on the depth chart. Mac Brown remains at the running back spot. He goes over left guard and into the hands of Brian Randolph. Redshirt junior, Wethersfield, Connecticut. 6'2", 210. And this is the fifth game in which he has played. Committed to Temple, and Steve Adazio, the head coach there, formerly offensive coordinator here with the Gators. Second down and 9.
Tennessee has been really using the field blitz, trying to stop this running game, bringing the eighth guy a lot already.
Well, Patton was down there trying to provide a block, but it wasn't very effective. Mac Brown tackled by Ladarrell McNeil, number 33.
You know, Tennessee started out okay, unbelievably, if you didn't see the game, against Oregon. You know, they started the game against the Oregon offense with a 3-and-out. Then Oregon missed a field goal, then kicked a field goal. So after 3 drives, it was 3-0, only giving up 3 points by the defense.
Right.
And then they scored on their next 8 drives, where an Oregon did. And they did it without the benefit of a turnover. They went long range against this Tennessee defense. And let's see if they can adjust.
Murphy escapes the sack. He's got 2 men open, but he's going to run and slide for the first down across midfield. That's A.J. Johnson, who had a hand on him, the linebacker, blitzing.
Tried to get him on the shoulder pad. He ducked it. And then now, as the backup quarterback in there, it's even more important than anything to preserve yourself. I'm sure Morningwig has gotten next to no snaps as the third-string quarterback.
That's a pickup of 8 and another first down 10. Jonathan Harrison snaps it back, and it's Mac Brown. Mac Jones, the starter, missed the first game because of the continuing effects of that serious viral infection. Mac Brown got the start in that one, and he rushed for 112 yards in the win against Toledo. And now Mac Jones is back on the field. There is Skyler Morningwig. 5:20 to go, opening quarter. Whoa, that's Jalapio, who got a little anxious.
Well, in that Miami game.
Start. Offense, number 67. 5-yard penalty, second down.
Because of the injuries in that Miami game without Jalapio, I mean, you look at a Florida team in the fourth corner, they'd already lost Chaz Green. They lost both of their tackles into that game. They were basically playing that fourth quarter against Miami with their fourth and fifth tackle in the game. So, you know, that's a position because of injury. And even today, you know, you're looking at a replacement at tackle for Florida.
5 wide. Here's Murphy. Goes for Dunbar at the 45-yard line, a little crossing pattern, and it is knocked away by Dontavis Sapp.
And now it's Jalapio again. He's down. He's got that torn pec muscle. Don't know if it's injured that again, but good defense again. Tennessee is saying, you know what, after playing against this Oregon speed, this doesn't seem too hard today so far. Kind of grabs Dunbar, gets away with it, and gets that right hand across to defend the pass.
And Jalapio still down, getting some medical attention. Well, they continue to tend to John Jalapio. Will step aside.
Daddy, Daddy, it's time for my
pectoral muscle. And is wearing a harness, was taken from the field and into the locker room. Ian Silberman is in his spot now. Here comes a rush and a flag.
I think it was Kyle Coney that time that jumped a little early. We got a shot right there, right tackle. Remember, he's in there substituting.
64, 5-yard penalty, remains third down.
And right now, don't you just think that Will Muschamp's saying, let's just run a play, punt this ball, and see if Tennessee's offense can make a first down against our defense?
I mean,
you don't want to make a mistake here. New quarterback in the game. Let's see if they call a conservative play and put their defense on the field.
Well, they will throw it. Murphy. Little crossing pattern to Burton underneath, and that's way short. Yeah,
very, very conservative.
Yes, it was.
Probably was, you know, one option down the field if it was man-to-man, if it was a deep safety, drop it off across the middle.
So that brings on Kyle Christie, who in the first possession of the game had a snap chin high, and he failed to hold on. Jacob Carter is the deep man. The protector is Burton. Drew Ferris snaps it back, this time easily controlled. And the punt will be taken at the 10-yard line. There you go. Well, Jeff Driscoll said he could not have played last week because of a sprained left knee, wearing a brace for the first time, and then, of all things, his right ankle injured. Left the field on crutches, no update yet. Well, there's been a strange quality thus far to this game.
Yeah, the word is sloppy. Florida mishandling a good snap. Tennessee calling the wrong play into the wrong defense. Jeff Driscoll getting sacked. Swafford cutting off an easy pass for a touchdown. Tennessee has taken advantage of a slow start by Florida. When you consider, there's 4 minutes to go in this quarter, Tennessee has run two plays in the game. Two plays.
First down, 10 Volunteers. Nathan Peterman getting his first start on the road in the Swamp. Redshirt junior. He's got it, and he's hauled down from behind by Antonio Morrison, the middle linebacker. Had some difficulty this summer with the legal authorities, so was suspended for, I'm trying euphemistically to explain why he didn't play the first game.
I'm tired of explaining those things.
Well, we did have another player suspended for this game for a violation of team rules. This one is tipped. There is no flag.
Well, right there you see Vernon Hargraves. I mean, one of the emerging stars in college football. When you watch him on the practice field, he reminds you of a Tyrann Mathieu. As comfortable as he is with the ball in the air, he's only a freshman. He came with big hype, and he's one of the few guys that have exceeded the big hype.
Here's a stat for you. The Gators have given up 2 of 24 third down conversions. 2 of 24. This is the first third down for Tennessee in the game. 3rd and 9. Blitz. Got him. Fumble. Ball is out. Who got it? Gators got it. Michael Taylor. Dante Fowler was a part of it all.
I think it was Fowler again who caused the fumble. They did it on the other side of the field. I think, let's see if it's Fowler right here defeating the block as Peterman comes up in the pocket, gets the fumble, and then it's recovered. Boy, Peterman off to a tough start. Calls the wrong play going in. Gets sacked on the first big third down play. And remember, we talked about how Will might protect his young quarterback. On the opposite side, they didn't protect him, and they're going to pay a heavy price if Florida sticks this into the end zone.
Again, the backup quarterback, Tyler Murphy, replacing the injured Jeff Driscoll, taken into the locker room with an injured... Oh, a fumble on the snap, and there's Marlon Walls. Now, did that hit the ground?
Sure did, but I tell you, this has been about as sloppy a first quarter as I've seen in a long time. handle the snap. Then you got to handle a pulling guard. He almost gets hit by Max Garcia, and he's lucky to get the ball back.
You're right. It's not exactly been an aesthetic
delight.
Oh,
man, I'm trying to say Florida's one of the most underrated teams in the country. I might have to sneak away from that. Nowadays in modern...
There is no sneaking away in the blogosphere.
I don't think so either.
No.
Holy cow, disaster so far for both teams.
Murphy back, blitz coming, good blitz pickup by the center. Now Murphy darts out to his left, into the end zone, overthrown, and caught by the Hedges.
I'll tell you, Butch Jones is all over. He has just increased 20 yards out on the field again. He's looking at that schedule in front of his team. He knows how important it is to get a big win for his program. He's got a bunch of recruits committed to his program. He wants to hold them. He knows what's in front of him, and he needs to steal a big win, a win that Derek Dooley never got.
No, Dooley with 7 losses in each of his 3 years as the successor to that guy who's at USC now, who lasted all of 1 year at Tennessee. Up the middle, Matt Jones. Well,
they're going to take the points.
Yeah. Bring on Austin Harden, who is 2 of 3 with field goal attempts this year. And he replaces a guy who was just wonderful during his time at Florida, Caleb Sturgis. So here's Austin Harden, 4th field goal attempt.
A great stop by the Tennessee defense. They answered it just like Florida answered it.
Kyle Crowfoot is the holder. The kick is up and good.
Basically 2 turnovers if he called the wrong play, and he's still up by 4.
After the field goal, Florida to kick deep. Austin Harden will kick off. And Vincent Dallas, number 6. Is the deep man for the Volunteers. Returnable from the 1. Only to the 17, perhaps the 18-yard line. Now let's go back to the studio for a Liberty Mutual update. Here's Tim Brendo.
Vern, Gary, this is one of those games outside the top 25 that's got a lot of meaning for both teams. Rutgers quarterback Gary Nova picked off here by Tevin Mitchell of Arkansas. He'll take it right back to the house, and it's 10-0 Razorbacks. They're trying to get to 4-0 for the first time in a decade. Nice start for Brett Bielema. Back to you.
Indeed it is. And they've got to visit Florida in a couple of weeks. Now here is Nathan Peterman. Right side, caught, short. Rajon Neal, the running back. Jalen Watkins, number 14, picked him up.
Well, it's obvious to all offices, and there's Justin Orley right there. You wonder how long, if Peterman can get this drive going, how long would Butch stick with Peterman, basically?
Now, Orley started the first 3 games of the year. Less mobile than Peterman. But so far, an ineffective quarterback job by the redshirt sophomore. Freshman rather. From behind, Rajon Neal. Well, let's give you a little more information on Peterman. First college start today. 36 passes in his senior season. Again, he is from a small town near Jacksonville. Gain of 12 on the last play. Fruit Code, Florida. James Stone snaps it back, reverse around the right side. This is Marquez North, And he's going to be very close to moving the chain.
Well, you can see that now with a quick first down right here. Butch Davis in his spread doesn't want to go too fast. But actually, he's going to get slowed down. He wanted to snap it quick, but he's going to get slowed down by a measurement on this play. They probably had two plays called in the huddle right there. The reverse, and they were going to come back with another play. And because they gained 9.5, 9.75, or 10.25, the quick pace was taken out of the offense.
Oh, just. Ooh. A smidgen.
Yeah.
About that much.
It's kind of a free play here, and I bet you, boy, if they could have got that play snapped early and quick like that, they would have loved that for Tennessee's viewpoint.
Now, heard the public address announcer say second down and inches. That's not plural. It's second down and an inch. Butch Jones, 45 years of age, came from Cincinnati where he served for 3 years. Prior to that, Central Michigan for 3 years. Outstanding record as he followed the career path of Brian Kelly, now the head coach at Notre Dame. Peterman will throw, like you said. Oh, no. Oh, brother, Josh Smith, who dropped a couple last week. He did have a 52-yard catch, but that was there for the taking.
Yeah, when you're a possession receiver, you better possess them when you're going to be on the bench pretty soon, because you've got to make those plays.
And so now third down and an inch. Rajon Neal, number 20, deep back, quarterback sneak. Looked like he got it.
One of the weirdest first quarters I've done in a long time, wasn't it? It's almost like both teams would rather have their defense out there.
I just, you know, here's a pig, let's put some lipstick on.
Oh, jeez.
That was ugly. But guess who's leading?
Pretty if you're a Vol fan, right?
The end of the first quarter, 7-3 the score. Back to Gainesville after this message and a word from your local station. Tennessee trying to break an 8-game losing streak to Florida. They are up 7-3 as we start the second quarter. With Tracy Wolfson, Gary Danielson, I'm Vern Lundquist. We are in the swamp, and it feels like it. First and 10, Volunteers. Nathan Peterman declared the starter.
Dominic Easley going crazy down there before the snap.
Oh, look at him. Oh, he's held up.
Yeah, but his penetration made a play.
Let's go down to Tracy Wolfson.
Well, guys, an update on Jeff Driscoll. They took him to the Student Health Center for x-rays because they no longer have imaging technology in the locker room. I just saw him come back on the cart, still on crutches, still unable to put any weight on that right ankle. They will look at the x-rays in the locker room. I'll pass along any information, guys.
Okay, thank you, Trace. Second down and 10. Peterman got some time, goes deep, got a man open, and he drops it. Well, Nathan Peterman getting his first start. Beat out Justin Worley in practice this week. And we've got Tyler Murphy as the quarterback for the Gators. Two names we really didn't expect to talk a lot about.
Right. And you could tell they both were shaky a bit. But now let's see if they can settle down a little bit here, because it appears that both teams, to go against these defenses, are going to need more than just a tailback off tackle here. They're going to have to get their quarterback involved in the game to make some plays. And you can't hide your quarterback all game.
Substitution infraction. 12 men in the formation for more than 3 seconds. 5-yard penalty, third down.
This is about the same spot on the field when Will Muschamp had to make a tough decision to kind of run a play he knew wouldn't get a first down and punt the ball. Let's see if Butch Jones will employ the same strategy here and put his defense back on the field.
And they go up against the most formidable third down defense in college ball. 2 for 25 yielded by the Gators in 3 games and a quarter. Antonio Morrison, number 3, in the middle. Peterman got protection, tipped. There's a battle for it, and it comes down for the Gators. Brian Poole, the nickelback.
Should have been intercepted once, and it was intercepted twice. I think Michael Taylor was the guy who had the first shot at it. Misses it. Got that's about as bad as you can miss one. And look at Tennessee gives up about 35 yards here by being too aggressive on that play. Threw that Damian Jacobs right in his face to Peterman. But that's 3 turnovers now by your second string quarterback. Will he change?
Well, Tennessee has had problems giving the ball to the Gators.
I said it was ugly, and it was for both sides. You know, these are good defenses. You know, last week, Tennessee got burned on defense by Oregon. So far, against the backup quarterbacks, neither one of these quarterbacks are able to do anything. And against that Florida defense, third and long, I speculated, would they just kind of give up a little bit, run
exactly.
A 5-yard play and punt. That's a 35, 40-yard gain when you punt it.
Play a little field position football.
Yes. Remember in 2009, Lane Kiffin came in here and kind of played real slow ball in that game and came within a late touchdown, had a fumble by Jonathan Crompton of making that a football game. So there is a way to play slow and make it a game.
First down 10 after the turnover, left side. This is Matt Brown. And let's go back down to Tracy Wilson with a report on John Halapio.
Well, guys, he is back out on the field. He came out of the locker room. He couldn't even open one of his eyes. I was told it was a head injury, but apparently he passed the correct test in the locker room, and he's back out there, guys.
All right, thank you, Trace.
Well, you can see his eyes were seem puffy right there. He must have got poked in the eye, and now he's got a shield on. You wonder why those offensive linemen don't always have shields on.
Exactly.
Right?
Four wides. Tyler Murphy gets the snap. Quick flip out. Good block by Burton. And here goes Solomon Patton flying in for a touchdown.
I mean, if you're a Tennessee fan, this looks like Oregon. You throw the ball short, and there's no defenders on the flank to turn it back in and make a play. And a 1-yard pass goes for touchdowns.
Austin Harden for the extra point. Crowfoot with the hold.
I mean, it's 2-on-2 to the outside. Tyler Burton said he did get the block, but come on. Burton right here goes out and gets the block on the end man out there, but where's the safety? What's happening to somebody out here? You got to save this play. Both players have bad leverage on the play. Devon Swafford, who had the touchdown for an interception, did not make the play. Swafford gets beat on a play that he's just got to make that play, and then no safety help to save it.
52 yards, Tyler Murphy to Solomon Patton, and the Gators are in the lead for the first time. Solomon Patton was a touchdown catch from 52 yards out. Their last game, he had 6 for 118 after only 9 receptions in his first 32 career games. And Tyler Murphy on in place of the injured Jeff Driscoll. Got the ball out on the wing. And a real defensive lapse by Tennessee.
Well, I think that's the same problem that Tennessee had against Oregon. The ball defending the perimeter and space, it does not appear that the secondary for Tennessee has the speed or the athletic ability to make those plays. Terrible angle by two safeties on the same play.
His heart with the kickoff. Vincent Dallas is deep and is chased all the way back 9 yards into the end zone. See more of today's game with the All-22 camera angle exclusively on CBSSports.com. This is what it looks like. Watch the action now live at CBSSports.com/SEC. Just a postscript, Gary, for those 8 consecutive touchdown drives by Oregon last week. The longest of the 8, the possessions, took 2 minutes and 18 seconds.
And listen to this if you're a proud defense. The drives, 5 of them, 73 yards, 78 yards, 80 yards, 80 yards, and 89 yards. There were no turnovers. Those were all following punts.
First down, 10, Tennessee. Marlon Lane is in the backfield now. That's Brandon Downs, the tight end, who moves in tighter to the right side, gets a block.
Hey, there's a movement on the offensive line. I think it was Antonio Richardson moved.
Prior to the snap, false start, number 74 of the offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Antonio Richardson.
Yep. Just bobbled just a bit to the inside. There he is, just kind of leaned on the play. Good call. You know, and we talked about could they depend on that offensive line, those 5 guys, but that wasn't pretty.
Marlon Lane.
And again, I think it was Dante Fowler coming off the
yeah.
Fowler's going, this is an interesting game. Nobody even tries to block me on some of these runs.
Quick flip out to the right side. Josh Smith hangs on to this one, but he doesn't get much.
Let's go back one play, a little bit of a hurry. Well, look at Fowler come off the edge again. He's already done this once. Comes back in again and makes another play in the backfield.
Tracy Gary reports from the sideline that Leon Orr, defensive tackle for the Gators, has been taken into the locker room. So, becoming a game of attrition.
Third and long. Let's see if they protect the quarterback here this time.
Oh, jeez. Goodness.
We might not be seeing Nathan Peterman much longer. They may give him a half, but this is not turning well for the changing of the quarterbacks.
Justin Worley, who started the first three.
Right. Call the play. This one sails on him about 6 yards too high, and right now there's no offense available for this Tennessee football team.
Peterman is now 2 of 7 with 1 interception. And Hargraves is back to return a punt for the first time this year. This is Pilardi with the punt. And Hargraves, the true freshman from Tampa.
I'm telling you, Tyrann Mathieu. And it's Tyrann Mathieu so far without the yellow hair so far.
Well, it's been frustrating for Butch Jones. Here's Solomon Patton scooting down the sidelines. Gators lead. Butch Jones on the sidelines. It's time to take a look at our Home Depot tools for success. We've got Butch Jones wired. He uses a microphone at every practice. Take a listen.
Square him up. Cylinder approach. Come on, AJ. Even in walkthrough. Hurry up, Cameron. Let's go. Get the ball back.
Well, the speed of the leader is the speed of the pack. Take control.
What are we doing, coach? Are we calling poison? What's the returner doing?
I'll tell you, one of the tools for success he may need going forward is he's got to survive this season and bring in some more talent.
Yes.
And he's doing a good job recruiting. That's the future.
This is Kelvin Taylor, the highly publicized running back, freshman running back, son of NFL star Fred Taylor. Butch Jones, 45.
Yeah, and Vern, Wednesday when I was there, he was all over the field. He's all in on trying to turn this program back to the way University of Tennessee was when they were competing for championships. And I got to say, I admire all his players. They've been through a lot, and they are buying in. They're trying to give the coach what he can.
Fumbled snap by Tyler Murphy, who got it.
Jeez, I'll tell you, this is as bad as I've seen.
Tennessee reacting as if they did.
Yep.
They did. Wow. Daniel McCullers.
Both offenses are going to start deferring when they get the ball back. He wasn't ready at all, was he, on that one?
Please, I don't want it.
But look.
He's looking to the side. It hits him in the face.
Yep. He wasn't even ready for the play. Lack of communication between he and Jonathan Harrison.
If you're a lip reader, just turn your head.
I was going to say, is it glad he's not mic'd? Peterman still back in the game. Peterman's surviving this somehow, and Tennessee's in the game.
Three down, they bring four. Ron Powell from the corner.
My goodness.
How about this? Pig Howard.
Play should have been blown up, and they survive again with Howard getting the ball somehow.
That's the wide receiver. Given name is Alton. They were going to try a pass from Pig Howard. It's second down and three.
It's not how it was drawn up, but they got 8 yards on it.
Marlon Lane, the backup running back, number 15. They'll go quickly. Takeaways by each. Three wides. Lane goes left, caught behind the line of scrimmage by Devontae. Well, he's having some game. Like they can't block him at all.
Well, sometimes they're not even trying. That might be one of the problems. He shifts down in and makes another play. This time a busted assignment, and who blocks number six?
Second down, 12. 10-7 Florida in an ugly football game. Well, everybody, my gosh, have you seen anything quite like that?
Well, last week I did, and they caught him. Throwing a pop-up. They're going to get an interference call on this one, aren't they?
Nobody in the offensive line moved. Jason Kroom was the intended receiver.
Yeah, that's one of those quick snap gimmick plays
right. Sometimes.
We've seen it before. The Bowdens have tried that play a number of times. Quarterbacks aren't really big fans of that play, by the way.
No.
Ball was thrown for Jason Kroom, but Hargraves is going to get the call on interference, isn't it? I don't know what happened at the end of it.
Pass interference. Offense. Number 18. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Remains second down.
Yeah, Jason Kroom actually pushed Hargraves away from the play. A disaster. You know, I can understand. Hargraves is an elite player that time, and you can see him as he pushed Hargraves past the play. You know, there's always room for a trick play, but you can't make it the base of your offense. And right now, you know, what do you do if you're Tennessee? Can't run the ball between the tackles, and you got a young quarterback.
How about a quick kick?
It ain't going to work either.
Cody Riggs made this stop on Marlon Lane.
See, one of the things, Vern, that Florida does is they man up. They're not going to give you, you know, those easy zone passes. They've got four defensive backs, safeties, and corners that can all cover man-to-man, and they challenge it.
What you got in your pocket for 3rd and 33?
Just anything but a turnover. Butch just signaled timeout.
Well, the swamp can be a hostile environment. Antonio Morrison trying to help get the crowd fired up.
Tim Brando in New York. Coming up on the Geico Halftime Report, Spencer Bryant and I will get you caught up on all the action, including Georgia surviving a scare from North Texas. Aaron Murray here to Chris Conley for the touchdown. Don't forget, they play LSU next week here on CBS. Now back to Tennessee, Florida.
All right, thank you, Tim. 10-7 Volunteers, 9:23 to go. And the timeout called by Tennessee. And Tracy saying that Peterman, the quarterback, might have injured his throwing hand on a helmet of a Gator defender in the previous possession, not this one. Across the middle, dropped. My gracious. That's Marlon Lane. Butch Jones said they dropped 16, or missed, I'm thinking the other way, missed 16 tackles against Oregon. I don't know how many drops they've had, but several in this game.
21 plays, 28 yards.
Hargraves, one kicking to one. This is Pilardi. Purifoy coming from the corner didn't really have a shot at the block. He does have one block punt this year. And this one will be downed at the 6-yard line. Well, I know we've been speaking about the Oregon Ducks for much of the first half. Let's cue this duck. Who are the three Tennessee head coaches to win their SEC debuts? Of course, Butch Jones coaching. It's the Aflac trivia question. Yard punt, nothing on the return. Gideon Ajobe, the fullback, he leads the way this side. And Matt Jones, number 24, was the backup to Mike Gillisley much of last year. Gillisley over 1,000 yards in rushing, and Jones was particularly effective in the last two games of last year.
Seems like Tennessee's having no problem with the tackle-to-tackle run game. You know, you've got A.J. Johnson, that's what he's best at, and that front is holding up very well.
Out of the eye. Stuttered behind the line as Matt Jones back in there. And Brent Brewer, number 17, makes the tackle. Third and three. Tennessee band is here. We've heard Rocky Top, I think, 14 times so far.
Well, you know, it's become a real interesting chess game here by both coaches. They both want to protect their quarterbacks. They don't want to turn the ball over, despite that they still are. Now you've got third and three. Will they try to find a running quarterback play?
Tyler Murphy comes left. Got a chance. First down. Gain of 11.
Yeah, well, they got a first down because the quarterback ran, but it was not a called run by the quarterback. It was just Murphy feeling the play and getting out of the pocket and making the first down.
And if you joined us late, Jeff Driscoll injured his right ankle. Here's a little hurry up from Florida. Said they were going to use some of this up-tempo today. Mack Brown is the running back. Play clock at five. Draw play. Mack Brown. Let's go to the studio for this Heisman Watch presented by Nissan.
Vern, Gary, if you're looking for some good backup quarterback play, look no further than the old horseshoe. Kenny Guyton had six touchdown passes in just a half. Let's go back to you.
And they are playing Florida A&M on this Cupcake Saturday in college football.
Yeah. one of the hardest jobs in this fast-paced offense is getting in those trips to New York. I mean, because a lot of teams don't go fast-paced, but they simulate the snap, and you got to come back and see what's happened.
Right. Here's the draw again. Mac Brown again.
I wonder if they're going to get Jalapio on that play. He pulled around, kind of walled his defender in, and I wonder if they called it late. Might have been inside on number 76, Max Garcia, too. One of the two.
Holding, 67 offense,
yep.
10-yard penalty, second down.
Yep, Jalapio came around against Jack Smith. Watch Jalapio right here, come around, pulls out, and then he has to read what the end does. 55, he reads him and he walls him in, gets his arm up around the helmet and the face mask, and that's why the call was made.
John Jalapio, the senior. And Murphy will go from the spread, Jones to his left. Kyle Coney, number 64, out at right tackle. Four wides, option. Matt Jones, A.J. Johnson flies over the top.
Yeah, A.J. Johnson did a good job that time. He sugared the blitz. What that means, faked the blitz inside. Came out, so he sugars inside, kind of holds the offensive lineman inside, comes out of it, and then runs down the option pitch to the outside.
How many years together for us now?
This is our eighth. Never heard that one?
Never.
What?
No.
It's called a sugar blitz. They kind of bring everybody in. I don't know why. They just, that's what we used to call it. Somebody else might call it something different.
No, I'm in your debt for teaching me something new.
It might not be right, though, for all I know.
No, but if you say it aggressively, third down, 10. Oh, he's hit from behind. Still completes it. Fumbles it. It's picked up by Tennessee. How do you do? Cameron Sutton, number 23.
Ball's dropped off nicely. Safe play, supposedly. You think it's going to be safe coming around? Call a play you can't get a turnover on, and you get a turnover anyway. Brewer that time, wasn't it? Number 17.
It was.
Brent Brewer does a nice job. He played safety a year ago. They've moved him to that speed will linebacker position, and he comes from behind to make that tackle and cause another turnover.
Well,
I'm telling you, the offenses are going to start deferring here.
Turnovers now even at 3-3. And Tennessee with the ball at the 28-yard line. Nope. Darius Cummings appeared to make the stop, and who's down? Damian Jacobs helped to his feet. Second and 9. Peterman pulls it back, gets it complete to his tight end, but the tackle is made by Jalen Watkins almost immediately, and here comes another one of those third downs.
Right. Jonathan Bullard that time, number 90, was right there for Peterman. He had nowhere else to go with that football. And man on the line of scrimmage stayed home and made the quarterback throw it real quick.
They bunch up on the left side, top of the screen. Now one of those receivers comes over to the near side. That's Pig Howard. Third and 9.
Ronald Powell, excuse me, Vern, is actually, even though he's playing linebacker, he'll eventually run rush.
Oh, it slipped out of his hands. It's picked off. Darius Cummings.
Oh, he got knocked down by his own guy. Easily was trying to hurry him up, and I think he tackled him on the play. Slips out of Peterman's hand. Now watch Easley say, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up on the play. This is going to be a touchdown probably. Easley knows it and says, come on, run, run, run. Tries to hurry him up and knocks him down. Oh my goodness. Disaster start for Tennessee. I mean, start out okay, but Peterman has had as rough a first half as anybody's had in a long time.
Well, that play kind of personifies the nature of this encounter.
Oh, yeah. Pac-10 fans right now are going, really? Really?
From behind, Mack Brown is hauled down by Brent Brewer. Easily knocked him over. And Peterman having a very, very rough first half.
Yeah, nice job by Antonio Richardson right there saying, all right, come on. You know, none of us are stars. As Worley's going to start to warm up right here. You can't really blame the coach. You know, he gave Peterman a shot. And he's got to go back to Worley now.
Second down, 11.
A lot of class by Richardson, though, sticking up for his teammate in that time.
Murphy. That's caught by Burton. And let's go back to the studio for a Liberty Mutual update. Once again, here's Tim.
Fellas, I'm going to try with another backup quarterback one more time here. Tommy Armstrong Jr. in for the injured Taylor Martinez, a turf toe. Here he finds Sam Burch, his first career touchdown pass. It's 28-17 now. Huskers 14 unanswered against South Dakota State. So the Jackrabbits have fallen behind. Back to you, Bert.
All right, thank you, Tim. Third down and 6 here.
You know, a lot of teams are having trouble with the hurry-up huddle, and it's given Tim Brando trouble, too. You know. he's having to adjust to this new...
Well, you know, Timmy has played by the word,
exactly.
So he can cram a lot into it.
He's done a good job, though, because it's hard nowadays going, I'll tell you.
Time called. Well, it's time now to answer the Aflac trivia question. I think if you're a longtime Volunteer fan, you might get this one. Who are the three head coaches to win their SEC debuts? Robert Kneeland and Phil Fulmer. W.H. Britton in 1935 when he replaced General Kneeland when he went back into the military service. Third down and 6. Nothing. Oh, yes.
That's it.
Murphy kept it. And did a good job with the ball fake.
Yes. And those are the plays that Driscoll, when he doesn't have that bad knee, brings to the table, too. But now, with Tyler Murphy, they just got to run the offense, whether you're your backup or not. They got to have it.
2:20 to go before the break. Florida up by 3. Backs in the eye, and that's Joyer in at fullback, number 41. And Mack Brown, who shared the running back responsibilities with Matt Jones so far today. Kelvin Taylor was actually in for one play, but did not get the carry. Here's Brown. And let's go back and revisit the interception and the role of Dominic Easley in this.
Yeah, Darius Cummings, number 55, ends up with the ball that slips out of Nathan Peterman's hands right here. Watch number 55 get it. But on further review, I think actually Easley trips up his right foot as he cuts across them from behind. They click feet, and that's what actually knocks him down on the play.
Second and 6, 1:27 to go. Trey Burton is in the Wildcat position. Handoff, missed tackle. And here goes Jones.
Well, this is right out of the Brent Peace Boise State handbook right here. A quick little handoff. It's really just a counter OT play. It's one of the basic plays with a little different twist to the ball handling. Safe play, different way to run it.
And it stops the clock with 1:17 to go. Both teams with 2 timeouts remaining.
Remember, Tennessee deferred. They will get the ball to start the second half. So, you know, can they survive? Will Florida obviously take it right down almost till the end of the half here?
Murphy keeps it again. He's being chased down at the 2.5. Corey Miller, number 80, made the tackle. Rough first half for that man, Nathan Peterman.
You know, this is kind of good news in a way for Florida and scary news for Florida. I mean, how many times can Murphy run this offense in this league week to week to week? They have not been able to run the ball with power against this Tennessee defense.
And again, it's an eye formation. Joyer leads the way. Mack Brown gets a block, scoots into the end zone, Gators score. from Harden for the extra point. Kyle Crowfoot of the special teams Crowfoot family. Max Garcia got a great block on that last touchdown run.
Well, this nightmare for Tennessee and poor Nathan Peterman started with the ball slipping out of his hands. Great field position. Murphy kept the ball a couple times and then power off tackle. Big Max Garcia came around and pushed Brown right into the end zone. Florida starting to take control.
37 seconds remaining in the first half of play here in the Swamp, and coming up, the Geico Halftime Report with Tim, Spencer, Bryant back in the studios in New York. Boy, you'd be hard-pressed to find 10 really competitive college football matchups today.
Right.
Oof. The strong have loaded up with the weak. Butch Jones.
Yeah, Butch Jones got a tough task here, Vern. I mean, even good offenses are going to have a tough time with this Florida defense. And Tennessee is not a great offense yet, and this rebuild goes on right now.
Harden will kick it off. It's Dallas number 6 back for the Volunteers. The unfortunate events of this first half was Jeff Driskel injuring his right ankle. Swafford picked it off.
It's been a tough year for Jeff Driskel. Started with an appendectomy in camp, went to a left knee in the second quarter in Miami, and you wonder if it might end. We don't know if it's broken or not, but he's getting x-rays. And, you know, that's maybe the one guy this Florida team can't afford to lose. There's not a lot of depth at quarterback here.
Justin Worley, who started the first three games, has replaced Nathan Peterman. There's a handoff to Rajon Neal.
Vern, just get a load of this. After Tennessee finished the Oregon game, and remember they scored the touchdown, the next 7 possessions against Oregon, they gained 72 yards in 7 possessions with no negative plays. Now so far in the first 6 possessions, this is the 7th, they've run the ball, they've had 25 plays for 31 yards.
Oy. Well, you see the stats on Justin Worley. 59%, and not as mobile, we're told, as the young man who started this game. And here's a conversation going on with Matt Moore, the referee, and it's a clock issue. Here we go. 5 passes.
Tennessee's not out of the half yet either. Florida, I'm sure, will muster.
One of the defense helmet came off. He will leave the game, and by rule, we will take a 10-second subtraction of the game clock. Please put the game clock at 16 seconds.
There's the helmet.
Well, why would they hurt the offense with the 10-second runoff when it was the defensive player? That doesn't make sense, does it?
It doesn't to me. I'm still trying to deal with the targeting rule. That is unbelievable.
Doesn't make a lot of difference. I guess
no,
they weren't going to run any more plays.
No. Well, the first half of this one would crack mirrors. It has not been pretty. But Florida, scoring off turnovers, takes a 10-point lead into the locker room at the half after Tennessee scored the first 7 points of the game. Let's go down to Tracy, who's with Coach Will Muschamp.
Thanks a lot. Coach, let me start out by asking about Jeff Driskel. Can you give us an update on that right ankle?
Well, he's out for the game, definitely. I don't know how much past that, but this is Tyler's game.
Well, what do you need to do to have Tyler have a little bit more success considering the inexperience he has?
Well, he's done a nice job of managing the game. He's bought a couple first down scores with his legs. He's made a couple nice throws. Matt's got to hold on to the ball right here, switching hands. You can't do that. We got to take care of the football better. We had an early snap. on one situation. That wasn't on Tyler.
Appreciate it. Thanks a lot, Vern.
Thank you, Trace. That's the end of the first half with our score 17-7. Now let's go to Tim Brando in our New York studios.
All right, Vern, coming up.
We welcome you back to the Swamp in Gainesville. We're about set for the start of the third quarter. And let's check in with Tracy Wilson.
Well, thanks, Vern. Guys, today we are honoring a very special person and his contributions to sports television. Our dear friend and colleague, Vern Lundquist, is celebrating his 50th year in broadcasting. Vern began his career August 31st, 1963, and became a Texas broadcasting icon as sports anchor at WFAA in Dallas and as host of Bowling for Dollars. But it's his presence at the biggest events and biggest moments that have made him a broadcasting legend.
Maybe. Yes, sir! There's the pass to Leitner. Puts it up. Have you seen anything like that? 3 seconds, two, one, over. Inexplicable. Oh, jump pass. How about that? Oh, my gosh. Those of us who love this sport live for nights like this. Alabama rush. Got him. No, they didn't. Oh, my gracious. How about that?
Hey, you guys should see Vern in the box up here. He's doing all this stuff. And again.
Well, you know, the jitterbug. Isn't that what they're doing?
I don't think so.
No?
I don't think so.
Oh, I love it when I had hair. And how do you get from Bowling for Dollars to the Masters?
And I'm very proud to have spent starting the eighth year with you, Vern. I'm very, very blessed.
Thank you so much, Gary.
It has been a great ride, hasn't it?
Yes, it has. And to see what this conference has become, disregarding what we saw in the first half. I was going to ask you what most impressed you about the first half of play.
Well, I will say this. When you count the last half, and I wrote it down here, since the last half against Miami, 35 plays, 69 yards, they held Miami to. And then 25 plays, 31 yards. The last 60 plays against this Florida defense, they've held their opponent to 100 yards. You can tell they're elite, but now with the Driscoll injury, where are you going to find yards now? Let's look at it from Tennessee's viewpoint. They're going to go back to their starting quarterback. They're down. They're in the football game. I don't see how they can give Florida any more points, though, and win the game. So if they can hold it at 10, get to the fourth quarter and score, maybe they can steal one here.
Well, Butch Jones said if we can just get the game to the fourth quarter. They started out on a positive nature, but things went south. 5 yards passing total, Tennessee. Let's just face it. We watched A.J. McCarron and Johnny Manziel last week.
Right.
We're not watching them today.
No, I mean, it was a very important game, I thought, for Jeff Driscoll and Florida. I mean, Florida's thinking of competing for the championship. And now if that injury becomes a season-ending injury, they may have to look at blowing the red shirt for their freshman, Staver, their young quarterback. I mean, because to get through this season in the SEC, they're going to probably need all men on deck at the quarterback position.
Now here's Justin Worley, who replaced the starter, Nathan Peterman. Peterman, 4 of 11 with 2 interceptions. And they've got a positive start as Rajon Neal gets out to the 41-yard line.
Well, we've talked about it, and I again think that at halftime, Butch Jones had to look at his offensive line, his experienced group, and say, you got to give me something. We've got it. We can't have negative plays. Now, remember, Vern, when Worley was in the game against Oregon, they did not have one negative play against Oregon. Maybe he's better at running the offense and not making the big mistakes.
This is Rajon Neal again.
Vern, Dominic Easley, even when he doesn't make the tackle, watch him get off the ball. I don't know, it's one of these two guys. I'm not exactly sure which one it is. But watch him get off the ball into the backfield. There he is. Wow, just blows up the play before it even happens.
And it's second down and six. Look at Easley. Did you see that little spin move? Went to the ground and got back up. Here's the pass. And here. Jason Kroon. Watch Easley.
Yeah, he is a superstar. I mean, he probably could have gone into the draft number two last year. Did not like his spot. He's got a lot of personality, and he plays with a fast motor the whole game. Every play. Never takes a snap off.
And he said he's been known to sing along when the band from Tennessee plays Rocky Top. Third and six. Worley goes right side, has a man open.
Sure did.
Pig Howard.
Wheel route and executed perfectly. Matched up against Purifoy too that time. Pig Howard was hurt in the game against Oregon. Purifoy was guessing. He was playing down in distance and he got burned.
Two receivers left side. 27 yards on that last pickup. Oh, boy. And let's go back down to Tracy for a real report.
Well, guys, Butch Jones obviously disappointed that his quarterback move didn't pan out, but he told me he needed to put Justin Worley back in to have some more rhythm, offensive rhythm. He said, we can't be in third and long. And, guys, that's exactly what he was looking for out of Justin Worley. He says it is his game the rest of the way.
Second and 10 here. That's the tight end Downs. Sets up to the right side. Rajon Neal trying to break loose.
Vernon was blown up again by Dominic Easley. He's going against an offensive line that has played a lot of SEC football, and Easley is in the backfield almost every play.
He told us yesterday that he was talked into coming to Florida without ever making an official visit. He had made an official visit to Oregon.
Right.
And at an all-star game, there were 12 Florida recruits, and a couple of them talked him into joining forces and coming here. He visited the campus only after he had committed. Worley flips it out. Oh, nice. Cody Riggs, number 31, up immediately on Pig Howard.
Well, the field goal was important for Tennessee. They traded one of those bunch passes. But the difference from Florida than other defenses is they play man. They man up those bunch passes. They don't limit any soft completions. And this one's what, 44 yards roughly?
Yes.
45?
Pilardi is 2 for 2 this year, both from short distances. This one looks perfect. Cuts inside the right upright. And Tennessee starts this second half on a positive note.
Sure did.
Pilardi from 44. It's 17-10 Gators.
Okay, so what kind of car should I get?
Gators lead 17-10 early moments second half. And Gary, take us through game trends. So
well,
far.
Most of this is what we discussed, plus Tracy's interview with Will Muschamp. Murphy did a decent job for a backup quarterback. Nathan Peterman gave it a shot. I think that thumb, hurting that thumb, might have hurt him late in that first half. Justin Worley is. This includes, by the way, the first drive of the second half. There you see the yards and the ugly one on the bottom. The turnovers in this football game, you know, both of these teams, Vern, are basically luckily they're playing each other.
Yes.
Because if they were playing somebody else, they might both be in deep trouble.
Absolutely. Here's Pilardi's kick. Lucius Purifoy has a chance to return it, and he will. Out to the 10. Cut down in the open field nicely at the 20-yard line. Let's go back to the studio for a Ford update. Here's Tim Brando.
Vern, Arkansas traveling to the Northeast for the first time since 1940. And against Rutgers, they decide to go with a halfback option pass. Jonathan Williams to Hunter Henry, 21 yards the strike. This is a significant win for the Razorbacks if they can hold on. It's now 24-7 in the third. Back to you.
Yes, it is, Tim. I agree. Great start for the new coach.
Yep. Oh, he's a solid football coach.
Yeah.
Yep.
First down, 10. Mac Brown is the running back. He goes around the left side and motors out. Gideon Ajobe, 13 yards.
Vern, you know, there's a risk-reward of putting your best cover corner on the kickoff. He took a shot right on his right thigh. Purifoy did. He's your best cover guy running those kickoffs. He limped off after that hit. And, you know, if I'm a... I'm sorry, you know, I've always felt this way, that I don't like to put my stars on the kickoff. I want a return man out there. Mm-hmm. I cannot afford to lose Purifoy on a kickoff.
Here's Tyler Murphy around the right side. And again, we referred to it in the game trends, how Driscoll injured his ankle with no complete report from Florida Sports Information Office.
I won't be too surprised if we don't see Trey Burton play some Wildcat, maybe even with Murphy in the game. If I'm the Florida staff, I can't afford Murphy. I mean, because you don't know how bad the news is with Driscoll taking a lot of hits.
Brown going left. B.J. Humphreys with the block. A.J. Mosley with the tackle, number 45. And they continue to work on Luchez Purifoy.
Yeah, I saw it right away when he got up. And I was about to say, like, boy, are you sure you want Purifoy out there? You know, to me, a punt return's a little safer than a kickoff return.
Mm-hmm. Gators.
Nice.
Brent Brewer, outside linebacker.
Yeah, that's one of the advantages of moving your safety into that will linebacker position. Brewer played, you know, safety in this defense a year ago, very comfortable in pass protection defense. Now you got to balance that. Can you hold up when people are running right at you in the run game? So far, Florida's not gashed them in their run game. Unbalanced line, an extra offensive lineman in down to the bottom of the screen here.
Mac Brown follows Joyer around the left side, and Tennessee's defense held up really well.
Third and long. To A.J. Johnson, number 45, he's had his some mild criticism, you know, from people saying he does not play great in space. You know, it's tough for these 240-pound linebackers to do match up against that Oregon spread. But I'll tell you, when he's playing conventional offense by Florida, he's something in the middle. He really is stuffing a lot of plays.
A.J. Johnson, who a year ago against Mississippi State had 21 tackles in the game. Murphy going deep right side. And it's over the shoulder, inbounds, out of bounds.
Murphy got it. He slid 1 foot there. Great catch by Dunbar. Florida should hurry up to the line of scrimmage. Tyler Murphy is very quickly trying to get him up there before the replay official can make a play and make a call. Did he get 1 foot in? See, the replay official should stop it anyway and not allow that. Now, in the NFL,
running on the field was a completed catch out of bounds. The previous play is under further review.
I think he got his left foot in, Vern.
I really do. Yeah. It's bang, bang, but I think so.
You know, in the NFL, that's a very good strategic play. He's got it. Does he control it all the way down? I think he does. A wonderful catch and a great throw by Murphy. In the NFL, the coach has to challenge. You can use that hurry up very effectively. But here, the replay official has control of the situation. Wonderful play by Dunbar.
Robert Rougeau is the replay official. And Dunbar with a really terrific bit of footwork.
Yeah, and you know, Justin Coleman was in decent position. I mean, that's a perfect throw. We saw that last week. Perfect throw, good catch. Really hard to stop those. you know, they may move the ball back a couple yards. I mean, you know, that could happen.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. First down.
You know, and wouldn't the Gators love one of these young, you know, receivers to break out? I mean, you look at the preseason All-SEC, there's not, as you look at Will, yep, first down, nice catch. And when you say, can one of our specialists emerge, maybe it's Dunbar.
Yeah, they are in need of playmakers.
Right.
Here's Murphy. Well played. Matt Jones back in the lineup.
And, Vern, going back to the preseason All-SEC, how often do you see a Florida team, when you go first team, second team, and third team, and not have one specialist name on there? You know, this was wide receiver fun and gun here.
Yes.
And nobody's there.
Second down, 5. Dunbar. Oh, there's a little dipsy doodle, and Solomon Patton has it.
Nice play by A.J. Johnson.
It sure was.
He's seen a lot of football, and he figured this one out as it was happening and ran it down.
Ooh.
See, Justin Coleman did what you're supposed to do. He turned it in. If you get beat to the flank, A.J. Johnson can't make that play. But he forced it inside, and they got help from his teammates.
Well, let's take a look at the Verizon Red Zone stats. 12 trips, 4 touchdowns. They were particularly ineffective at Miami 2 weeks ago.
Yep.
Turnovers inside the red zone were just terrible. Here's Murphy. Well, how about that? 13-yard gain.
And this one's a design called play all the way for a keep. The outside receivers, Trey Burton gets a nice block on the outside. You get Quentin Dunbar after he makes a catch. He makes a good block. That was a design keep all the way.
And a first down goal for the Gators. Murphy, very effective here. Second quarter and this opening drive of the third.
Here it is, a tackle, another tackle in the game right there.
Jones is the deep back. Play action. They go to Jones, and it's incomplete. Brent Brewer with pretty good coverage. That was for not Jones. He went to the fullback.
Yeah, Ajabi that time. Gideon Ajabi slid out into the flat. This is basically the first play action pass you put in fall camp. Fake it to the tailback, slide your fullback out to the flat. Although number 25 Ajabi was a linebacker last year, and you mm-hmm. might see why.
That did not remind me of A.J. McCarron and Jocelyn Fowler last week. Hunter Joyer is now in the fullback. And Matt Jones, the deep back. They overload on the right side.
Nothing there. We bounced out.
Yes,
nice play.
Touchdown, Gators. Hunter Joyer with the block. Matt Jones with the 6 points.
Daniel Hood almost made a play here. Jalapio comes across. He forces the ball deep, and then lack of leverage. One guy blocked two Tennessee football players. Bounce out for a touchdown. Nice read. Nice run that time by Matt Jones.
And perhaps the most effective offensive possession by the Gators in the ballgame. Austin Harden tacks on the extra point. That one 79 yards in 11 plays, and it chewed up 5 minutes and 9 seconds off the clock. So here in the third quarter, Tennessee gets a field goal. Gators answer with a touchdown.
Humans. Even when we cross our T's and dot our I's, we still...
...of the game presented by Napa Auto Parts. Let's quickly get down to Tracy Wolfson.
Well, guys, Florida cornerback Luchez Purifoy on the training table with a left thigh injury. He has ice wrapped around it, and as you said, it happened on the kickoff return. And Gary, if you remember, in the Sugar Bowl last year, also got hurt on a kickoff return.
Yeah. You know, Vern, since 2010, I've done it before, but it became, as we look at it one more time, it actually is his right thigh that he takes the hit on, almost right on the thigh. Alabama against Auburn, remember Julio Jones was on the kickoff, and I said, why is he out there? He got hurt, and he was not available in that last drive when Greg McElroy and Alabama needed him. It was a big play for Auburn to go, and when they made their run for the national championship, not having Julio Jones on the field.
Well, Jeff Driscoll left the game with an injured right ankle, out for this game. We don't know the seriousness of the injury, but now Purifoy appears that he might be out for this game. Here's the kickoff, and Vincent Dallas with the return, but not for very much. And let's go back to the studio for this Heisman watch presented by Nissan. Here's Tim.
Vern, you and Gary are going to see this guy next week. Aaron Murray threw for 408, three touchdowns, ran for another. Georgia knocks off a pesky North Texas today. They get LSU next week on CBS. Johnny Manziel at A&M will try to bounce back against SMU tonight. And Brett Hundley in UCLA entertain New Mexico State in Pasadena. Back to you.
All right, and thank you, Tim. First down, 10.
I think he's got three of them. I mean, those are three key guys right there in the hunt for it.
How about a week ago, that UCLA comeback in Lincoln against Nebraska? First down, 10. Hundley starred in that game. Right side. Oh, a nice tackle. Marquez North with the catch, and Brian Poole with the tackle. Now let's take a look at today's poll question. Which head coach, speaking of Nebraska, which head coach's hot seat is the hottest? Bo Pelini, Mac Brown, or the much beloved in Tennessee ex-coach Lane Kiffin?
Right.
Oy. USC did have a big win last week against Boston College. And they've got Utah State tonight.
Vern, you said Florida had their best drive, their last drive. Actually, Tennessee also had their best drive of the game last drive. Let's see if they can convert. Remember, Luchez Purifoy not on the field. Can they attack that position? Jalen Watkins is back at corner.
That puts a freshman at safety. Marcus May gave up a big play against Miami. And here is Marlon Lane, number 15. 6 yards on that one. 24-10, Florida. Intercepted. Wow. Javari Gorman would have been unimpeded.
Yes. Javari Gorman just sneaks. One of the few times you're going to see Florida play a zone, and I think that confused Worley on that play.
Well, Nathan Peterman got the start. Ineffective. 4 of 11 for 5 yards. 2 interceptions. And replaced by the young man who had started the previous 3 games, Justin Worley, but his yards per attempt was the lowest in the SEC. That was one reason they didn't find him that effective. This one goes over the head of Marquez North, number 8.
Remember, if you're a Florida fan, you know this. Florida has already, without Marcus Roberson, another one of their corners. So that means 2 corners. Roberson's out with a knee, and now Purifoy with that helmet to the thigh. So But now they got a true freshman corner out there, Vernon Hargraves, who's a star.
Yes.
And then they move Jalen Watkins. But with the spread offenses, you're down to playing your safeties over the slots.
Five-man, oh, three-man, four-man rush. And that one's complete out on the right side of Marquez North. But another unsuccessful third down.
They played zone coverage on every play of that series.
Pilardi on to punt. Hargraves, the freshman, returning punts for the first time this season in this game. So it's one punting to one. You know what?
Tipped
out
of bounds.
Tip out
of bounds. Tipped it right out of bounds.
Very smart. Darren Kitchens, very smart or accidentally brilliant?
Yeah, well, I think he knew exactly what he was doing. He saw it. Kitchens comes over and says, get it out of bounds.
Yep.
Beautiful.
So Hargraves muffs that one. But to hear Will Muschamp rave about this young man is something.
Yeah, you know, there may be another just factor. You know, Hargraves early in his career, and, you know, that bat, it may be batting of the ball. I don't know if you're, you know, no matter what, it's worth the play for Florida to get it out of bounds. But, you know, it's one thing catching punts in practice, and another after you've just run all over the field in the third quarter of a game and you're winded and tired and making the same play. Hargraves looked tired when he came off.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think Will Matt cares where this ball's spotted. Even if it's a 15-yard penalty, he doesn't care, as long as it's his ball.
Matt Moore will let us know. Muschamp now in his third season as a head coach.
Sometimes we don't know the rules. It appears they might not know the rule on this one. You get the feeling?
Illegal batting on the receiving team. He batted the ball forward, out of bounds. It's a 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
Well, I wonder if that's reviewable because he batted that ball
sideways or backwards.
He really did. Now, I don't know if penalties are reviewable, but I think he batted this ball backwards. See?
Yeah.
He batted that backwards. And we'll find out if that's reviewable. I'm going to ask my spotter to find this in the next 10 seconds. No, he didn't do it. We're going to go to a commercial.
It's David Moulton, after all. College Football Today program. 24-10 here. That last play, Gary, we're told, was not reviewable.
Now, they, I believe, got it wrong that it was actually batted backwards, but it's not a reviewable play. You know, a tipped pass is it, you can review that, whether the ball is tipped on a pass interference, but obviously that one is not.
Tyler Murphy seeing his first action. On in place of the injured Jeff Driscoll. Hand off right side to Mack Brown. This is the Mack Brown who is not on the hot seat.
Right. A.J. Johnson running sideline to sideline making plays, but that was a pretty successful one by Florida.
That was a pickup of 8. Rushing yards, 151 to 57. This Gator defense, which is getting rest right now, averaging only 50 yards yielded per game. Right side, Matt Brown. And now Red Lobster presents today's scholar athlete, a running back For the Gators, Mark Herndon, major family, youth, and community sciences major, and a GPA of 3.13, Red Lobster's commitment to the investment of our future is shown today by donating $1,000 to Florida's General Scholarship Fund. From Ocala, less than an hour away. Murphy, nobody open. So he'll take off. Nice cut at the 50. And he spins and picks up another 5 yards, Tyler Murphy.
Well, he sure is giving that dimension that a healthy Jeff Driscoll gave the Florida team last year when he rushed for, you know, all those yards against his Tennessee team. Athletic, making plays. There was nothing over that time. There was only a two-man route. He had nobody to throw to, so he made it with his feet.
Being chased by Jacquez Smith, the defensive end. Murphy now with 7 rushes for 83 yards.
Remember, Florida last year rushed for over 300 yards. This has been the field blitz. Basically, Brewer's been coming off this as a linebacker. He's basically a nickelback playing linebacker. He's coming off that slot all day.
Mac Brown hit first by Dontavis Sapp. Nearing the final 2 minutes of the third quarter here in the Swamp. Driscoll injured in the first half of play. Murphy pulls up, sidearms one. Oh, dear. Oh, man. It bounced off Solomon Patton's shoulder.
Yeah. I mean, Murphy got him into a play that should have been made. He throws a beautiful ball, and this is a rather easy catch for a Division I receiver that's recruited by Florida. And he knows it.
Fourth and 10.
Third,
I'm sorry. Three-man rush. Patton slips the tackle. Got it first down. Makes amends with that play.
I think Jerron Toney, number 35, is the guy that broke down on the play. Another one of those safeties that are not making plays in space. Now, you can imagine, if you're going up against Oregon with their high-powered offense, what that turns into. By that time, number 35, Toney, did not make the tackle. Should have been a position where Florida either had to go for it on fourth down or kick a long field goal.
Now Matt Jones is back in with Hugh Joyer, number 41. Jones. Well, they ran him against Oregon. Of course, I think the most well-known up-tempo offense in the country. Look at this time of possession between the two top line plays per game, because Florida does go at a slow pace. And Oregon averaging 24.4 seconds per play, and the Gators at almost 31.
Yeah, you know, Oregon in time of possession is 117th, and Florida's fourth. That's the contrast that Tennessee has faced week to week.
Murphy across the middle. Quentin Dunbar. Tell you, Murphy's becoming a man today.
Burn on Friday. Remember when I said to Jeff Driscoll, when he said he might not have been able to play last week if there was a game, and I looked at him, I go, if you can play, you play, because if the next guy comes in there, you might not get your job back.
Wally Pipp, anybody?
All these guys have dreams.
Sure.
And you can believe that Tyler Murphy's been dreaming that, you know what, Will Muschamp just doesn't see me. But if I ever get a chance, he's going to know who I am.
That's the end of three with our score 24-10 and the Gators driving. We'll return to Gainesville after this word from your local station. We begin the fourth from the swamp in Gainesville, Florida, with Tracy Wolfson, Gary Danielson, Vern Lundquist here. Tennessee jumped off to a 7-0 lead, but Florida more or less in control since then. The Volunteers plagued by turnovers, and Florida, with Jeff Driscoll injured, has gotten really good play out of Tyler Murphy. That's Patton in motion. Hand off Jones up the middle, down to the 5 or the 4 yard line. I just think, Gary, we've got to talk about the play of this young man, Tyler Murphy.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he saved the day. Let's be honest. I mean, Butch Jones tried to find some lightning in the bottle by switching quarterbacks, and Will Muschamp was forced to go to his second quarterback, and one came through and one didn't. And it's a tough position. I mean, also, one guy's going against the Florida defense.
Yes.
That is a little tougher to do. And, you know, I mean, you know, I've said Florida's got an elite defense, but they need something more on offense. You know, Jeff Driscoll's a highly talented player, but he's been making mistakes. So far, Murphy has not made the critical mistake.
As we said earlier, he's a young man who originally is from Connecticut, and he originally, as you watch him scramble here, he committed to Temple, where the head coach is former Florida offensive coordinator Steve Adazio, and was.
And you know, Vern, if you think about it, the two ends of the spectrum, I mean, Oregon is about pace and space. Florida's about smash, and they're looking for some flash. They have not found the flash part of it. The stuff that Julio Jones and A.J. Green and Todd Gurley, some of those big plays outside of the smash football, that's what Florida's missing on offense.
Timeout called by Butch Jones and the Volunteers. We'll be back in a moment. Thursday on CBS, Academy Award winner Robin Williams returns to television in The Crazy Ones. Premieres Thursday at 9, 8 Central only. CBS.
You know, the other part of this, going back, Vern, we were talking about Tyler Murphy, is you never know when a guy is just going to be a gamer. You know, you watch him in practice, and yeah, he doesn't really turn you on. But remember, the quarterback's not being hit in practice. He's taking the second team against the first team. Some guys can't handle the crowd, and some guys just can't. And you never know it until they get in the game.
Murphy most impressive in this one, coming on after Jeff Driscoll suffered an injury to his right ankle. Three-man front for the Volunteers. Quarterback draw, that was designed. Oh, wow! Touchdown, Gators! Murphy all the way!
Possession game. This was a logical call that Murphy got it into the end zone for.
Austin Harden with the extra point. Officially marked as a 7-yard touchdown run. Tyler Murphy, in his first action, has now carried the ball 9 times for 87 yards. It's been Murphy time.
And now it's time for our GEICO game recap.
Well, it was Tennessee that jumped off to a 7-0 lead. Jeff Driscoll picked off by Swofford. He went down the sidelines on a 62-yard interception return, and it was on that play that Jeff Driscoll suffered the right ankle injury. He was already playing with a brace on his sprained left knee. 7-0 Tennessee with 4 first half turnovers. Here was the ugliest of the quartet, and that was intercepted by Cummings. Now here's a wonderful play by Solomon Patton, zipping down the sideline and in for the touchdown, 17-7. Mack Brown got a good block from Joyer, hopped into the end zone, 24-7. Here was Mac Jones, another running back. That made it 24-10 after a Tennessee field goal. And just a moment ago, Tyler Murphy, he's never lettered at Florida. He's a junior. And getting extensive action in this game and coming through in a big, big way. 31-10. Austin Harden will kick off. Vincent Dallas is deep. Florida might be just a few moments away from winning its ninth in a row in this series. Dallas will bring it out.
That's for sure.
Davis with the tackle.
Probably the most dangerous play we have in football is the kickoff. Two teams lining up, running a 40-yard dash at each other, and there's a lot of heavy collisions.
One reason the NFL has changed its rule.
Oh, yeah. And I think that the college should even look more into what to do with the kickoff. Mm-hmm. Still too many players getting hurt on it.
31-10. Justin Worley removed as the starter in a decision made, well, officially made last night. But he's back. Whoa, boy. Wow. And that's good. Oh, is that targeting?
We're going to get called.
I wonder. Brian Poole, this is the most controversial new rule.
Yeah, and this happened in the second half, so he's, you know, this is going to hurt him next week. Oh, yeah, that penalty. He's out.
Guess what?
He's out of game. And remember, they've already lost. Now they're down numbers. Yeah, that is a clear penalty, and that's exactly what they're trying to get out of football.
Targeting an offensive player above the shoulder on the 24 of the defense. By rule number 24, it's disqualified.
We were told by the replay officials they will review every one of them because it's such a big penalty. But I can tell you that one's going to be upheld. And rightly so, right,
yes,
Vern?
Oh, I so agree. Last week, Clinton Dix.
Yep.
That's a tough name to get right. He was called for targeting, and it was overruled by the replay official. Here's Rule 9, Section 1, Article 3. No player shall target or initiate contact against an opponent with the crown of his helmet. When in question, it is a foul. I think this, to both of us, was clearly targeted.
Yep. It's an instinctive play. I get that. But there's last week. This was
after
where
review,
Clinton Dix went for it.
The ruling on the field is confirmed. Number 24 is disqualified. First and 10.
And he knew it, and his teammates knew it. We understand it's instinctive, but it still has to be coached and by rules and penalties kind of legislated out of the game so the players realize what they can't do.
Reverse. Pig Howard, nothing. Jabari Gorman, something. Number 21.
And Vern, let me just go back. You know, that last penalty that was called, a targeting play, that was a normal play in college football just a few years ago. I mean, there's been some great safeties at Florida and all over this league that made that message play routinely. And now in a few years, we won't be seeing that anymore, and that's good. Wrap up out there.
Jalen Watkins, yep. On Marquez North. Yes, it was.
And the coaching technique that the coaches are telling the defensive players, if you don't want to get called, bring your arms. Watch him bring his arms and wrap up. If you wrap up, you're very unlikely to get called for a targeting penalty.
So with Purifoy already out with a thigh injury, Brandon Poole is out. Roberson
is out
with an injury. They're getting a little skinny in that defensive secondary.
Yeah, they're probably only down to 9 more recruits.
Worley, oh, wide open. Marquez North. That's got to be a busted coverage.
Yeah, that's the biggest play in a long time. Jalen Watkins is the corner to the wide side of the field, but apparently a lack of communication between two players who didn't practice all week at those two positions. You know, Jabari Gorman thought that Watkins was going to take him, and Watkins thought Gorman was going to take him.
Gain of 32 and a first down at the 32.
And we only had one play last week against Oregon that long in the game. Over 20 yards.
Rajon Neal down to the 25. Somebody's helmet slips off. That was Michael Taylor, so he's going to have to sit out for a play.
There's that shift again by Easley. Played the whole game and he's still got energy.
Neal going left inside the 20. And Antonio Morrison, number 3, made the tackle.
Shift down. He's got his own way of doing it.
Oh, goodness. Well, he's got an engaging personality.
Yep.
And his coaches say he is among the most competitive players on the team, also notable for his quickness off the ball. They slip it up the middle to Rajon Neal.
And he pushed James Stone right in the backfield again on that play. Now, Tennessee, I think they got South Alabama next week, don't they? And then they start the run.
Tennessee does,
yes.
And then...
then they start the run of the heavyweights.
Georgia at home, yes.
So then they got the heavyweights after that. But, right now, if you're Butch Davis, of course, you might have Butch Jones. That's not fair, all these same names. Butch Jones is going, okay, let's make a statement. You know, one of the themes... Go ahead, call this play, Vern, sorry.
All righty, that's okay. Here's Worley coming. Oh, he's got him. Touchdown.
You can see the breakdown on this Florida defense. They just do not have the experience now. This time, Cody Riggs is going to be the guy with the bust.
Pig Howard made the catch for the TD, and Riggs victimized on the play. Rocky Top. I bet Easley's not singing.
Yeah, and you know, the theme I was going to say that Butch Jones and his seniors have been saying is nobody's going to feel sorry for us. I mean, we're going to have to earn every win, and let's put some drives together at the end of this game and see what we can get for next week, too. Well, there's two guys covering two guys, and let's see who makes the mistake here. And these two have these two. Let's try to figure out what happened. Cody Riggs switches. They kind of delay. He thinks it's going to be a quick screen, and it wasn't. He got baited into a bad play by Pig Howard. Nice design play by Tennessee. And, hey, down 14. We've seen this before, right? Let me see if there's a Johnny Manziel over there. No, I don't see one.
The Home Depot SEC on CBS is sponsored by Verizon. State Insurance. Red Lobster. And by Bud Light. 10:20 to go in the game. A nice drive by the Tennessee Volunteers. 31-17. Driscoll out. Ankle injury. Murphy 8 for 13. And he's rushed 9 times for 87. Florida with 362 total yards. Against a Tennessee defense that yields a few, 678 to Oregon last year. And this is a Tennessee defense. I don't mean to pound on folks, but they were dead last in the SEC a year ago with about 6 different categories.
Let's do an attaboy for Justin Worley, though. He lost his job. He stayed ready. He got in the game, and now he's 7-11 for, 89 yards. He's done his job.
Solomon Patton on the kickoff return gets a downfield block and then skips out of bounds. That block was from Trey Burton. Let's revisit the day, making a memory for Tyler Murphy.
Well, it started out with an easy pass. That's good coaching. Got a guy coming in the game. Don't give him difficult passes. It turned out to be a big play. Dunbar helped out his young quarterback. It was a perfect throw, but a better catch. And then Murphy's legs have been a story in the game. On busted plays and break plays that weren't really designed, he made plays outside of the offense.
Ball on the 38-yard line with 10-11 to go.
Big stop here for this Tennessee defense. Let's see if they can put a little pressure on Florida in this game.
Mack Brown goes right. Tackle near the 40, perhaps just across it. Daniel Hood, number 97. Dontavis Sapp, number 41. That's Butch Jones, who's most impressed him in his first season. And defensively, Dontavis Sapp.
Was the first guy he mentioned.
Yeah. 31-17, under 10 to go. Brown. And let's get more on the Jeff Driskel injury. Here's Tracy.
Well, guys, we saw him being taken to the locker room. We know that he went for x-rays. And remember, Florida does not give any injury information out, so we don't know what the result of those x-rays were. But keep in mind, we have not seen Jeff Driskel back out here at all the rest of the game. And to me, that is not good news for Florida.
I think we would concur, Trace.
Huge third down for Tennessee.
Yep.
Can they get a stop? Will Florida throw the ball or try to run it?
They'll run, and they come left with Mack Brown. There's a pursuit and a missed tackle. Hunter Joyer leading the way again.
I think Cameron Sutton might have been able to stop him short, but Mack Brown made a miss on the outside. Look at that. It was very, very bad angle again. I think he still would have gotten the first down, but that's going to be embarrassing on tape when the coaches watch that one.
Well, this ground game is working effectively. There'll be few complaints, I would think, from the fans of Florida. They're over 200 yards on the ground now.
And it's been the story for the last 8 years, the ground game in this series.
Oh, wow. Brian Randolph, number 37.
Yeah, big Daniel McCullers, the big, huge defensive tackle, turned it back inside, and then the tackle inside to get the stop by Randolph. You know, not only is Brent Peace and Will Muschamp now protecting their second-string quarterback, but they need to take clock off because they're hurting in the secondary. They only got five live guys in the secondary that practiced at all this week. And you can see they're already making mistakes.
Second down and 13. It'll be third and a bunch is Matt Jones.
Yeah, I'll tell you, there's some gripping going on right now on that Florida sideline. They're blowing coverages in the secondary. He lost his star cornerback on the kickoff. He has an ejection.
And a starter, Marcus Roberson, was already out.
And they moved Jalen Watkins to safety. He didn't get much practice time at corner.
Yeah.
This is a mishmash back there.
And I think we saw it in the last Tennessee possession.
Two of them. Two big busts on those plays.
Third and 13, Murphy has Jones to his right. Back to throw, four-man rush, steps up.
Nobody to throw to.
Throw it away.
Yep, nobody, no receiver to help.
Volunteers hold, and they will get the ball back.
I'll tell you, Tennessee and Butch Jones is looking at his team and going, the pressure's on them. 14-point game. We showed that we can move the ball. Plenty of time.
Kyle Christie on to punt. And Jacob Carter is the return man. Well, the Volunteers scored on a touchdown pass from Worley to Pig Howard to get within 14 on their last possession. Here's the fair catch made just inside the 10. It was Worley who was in relief of Nathan Peterman today, and he's played very well. He finds Pig Howard over Cody Riggs, and Muschamp gave his defensive back more than an earful. .639 remaining in the ball game. Tennessee does have its worst starting field position today. But how about the day for Devontae Fowler?
Well, you're right, Vernon. And right now, the secondary needs Devontae Fowler to make a couple plays like he did early in this football game when he dominated the game and caused a couple of turnovers. Because that secondary is hurting in the back end. Can Fowler or Easley or Bullard make a play to bail them out back there?
Dante Fowler with a heck of a game so far. Here's Worley. Finds Jason Kroom. And they're going to hurry. Jabari Gorman.
That was just a prayer of a throw. He didn't have where he wanted. Florida's playing zone. Florida hates playing zone. They're sitting back. They've got deep safeties. They're playing a two-deep zone. And watch Justin Worley turn and look and look and look and then throw off his back foot to the right without even thinking into double coverage. Terrible mistake at this juncture of the game.
Turnovers for Tennessee in the ball game. Butch Jones with a word for his quarterback.
Vern, Gary, and Tracy.
All right, Tim, thank you. 28-24 in that one. It's 31-17 here. And Justin Worley, ill-advised throw. Intercepted.
Yeah, I want to point out a little more to this. So, and just to salute a guy who plays through every play.
Brent Brewer.
Remember what I was saying? Somebody up front needs to help this young secondary. Well, watch Dominic Easley. He's going to get matched up against the offensive guard Bullard right here. Watch what effort can do to the quarterback. Gets double teamed and then he spins, and I think it double clutched Worley's throw. Just enough where on a play where, you know, and he's explaining to him exactly what he did on the play right there. And there's a guy that's got a motor that I would like to have on my team. I mean, he plays, he's a true All-American, one of the best offensive defensive tacklers you'll see in college football.
Nice gap on the right side, and Mack Brown exploits it. And let's answer our Facebook poll question, who's most on the hot seat? And only 4% picked Bo Pelini, only 35% Lane Kiffin, 61% Mack Brown. It reminds me of something that a former Florida coach named Ron Zook once said. There is noise in the system.
Right.
And that applies to what's going on in Austin right now.
Well, these big jobs, you know, these icon universities, they pay well, but you just have to win them all. That's all.
That's right. There's Mack Brown again. Well, Will Muschamp, in our conversation with him yesterday, was talking about Jeff Driskel and the criticism Driskel is receiving. And Will said, be careful what you ask for. Yep. You want to play quarterback at Florida? It kind of comes with the territory. You want to be the head coach at Florida? It kind of comes
sure
with
does.
The territory.
Or Texas or Michigan or everybody else.
Muschamp said, it's a lonely seat. Time call.
Who plays a style like Oregon? I mean, this is not going to be easy for these guys. And, you know, I have all the respect in the world for these players that go through these transitions with these coaches. I mean, after this play, if it's not a big bun for some type of...
And it's not. It's A.J.
Just think about this. You know, they're going through a transition with a coach. I mean, they run just as many wind sprints as Alabama. They have the 6 a.m. work, lifting all off season. They have to change everything brand new for a new coach and buy in. And I want to be honest. I don't know if this Tennessee team is going to win the championship. But hopefully, if I was Butch Jones, I would say, help me lay the foundation for some other team in the future to win the championship. And that's what this team might be remembered as.
Well, we were chatting with him yesterday on the phone from their hotel in Ocala, and he said, brick by brick.
Yes. I remember when Jim Tressel went to Ohio State, he did the same thing with that first team. They set the tone, and they went forward.
There's a loss on the play. 3:45 to go. Well, Peyton Manning, who was probably the most illustrious ex-football player in Tennessee's recent history, now playing for the Broncos. He came back to Knoxville this summer and spent 3 hours with the entire coaching staff just watching film and talking about the transition. I happened to see him after a Bronco preseason game. He went out of his way to tell me, I love this coach and I love his commitment. He wants to be at Tennessee, unlike a certain other guy who bolted for Southern California. Butch said, these kids have had 5 or 6 position coaches.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, from Rocky top to bottom. And it really, this decline, and we all respect and know Philip Fulmer, but his last 4 years included 2 losing seasons. Then the wretched experiment with Kiffin. They brought in Derek Dooley, and he lost 7 games in each of 3 years.
Vern, some have speculated that it turned our first game when Florida won 21-20. They're up 17-7. Remember Chris Lee, a couple touchdown passes, end of the third quarter, the fourth quarter. But I really think it might have been the Eric Ainge touch interception in that SEC championship that really sealed the fate for this Tennessee program.
That's a 40-yard effort that's wide left. And Butch Jones out urging his team on.
Still 14. Still 14.
With 3:39 to go. Here's Florida's schedule. They're on the road at Kentucky. And then back here on October 5th against Arkansas. Arkansas, by the way, as Tim told you, now losing at Rutgers. They've got to go to Texas A&M next week.
Right. Now, can Murphy take the job, or can he hold down the fort and win until Jeff Driscoll gets back for that LSU game? I mean, that's the question now for Florida. Will it become Murphy's team, or will he hold it down if Driscoll can possibly come back if he doesn't have a broken ankle?
Ronald Powell with the pressure and a nice defensive job by Cody Riggs.
He did that one right. It was almost, I think, the same play they hit for a touchdown.
Well, it's that conversation he had, a one-way conversation with Muschamp on the side. Cody Riggs has proven that he listens well. And there was his head coach to applaud him as he fell at his feet. Second down, 10.
You know what I think Tennessee needs, and Butch is going to look for it all year. Remember, I'm going back to that Tressel thing because I was doing those games back. Remember, Tressel got that win at the end of the season at Michigan and kind of said, listen, what we're doing is right. We're on the right path, and ended up leading to a national championship just a year later. Where is Butch Jones going to get that big win that Derek Dooley never got?
There's a ball. Oh, Pig Howard knew that he was going to get belted, and he concentrated on making the catch before the contact came.
Yep. I mean, this is one where if you're a defensive coach, you say, this can't happen. A guy throws a pop-up down the middle of the field, and he gets a completion, but it did happen, and still, hate to say it, still a football game here. Got to really admire the way these Tennessee players have hung in this football game.
Worley.
Best throw of the day.
Another one that's on the mark to Jason Kroon.
Yep, best throw of the day for either team, I think, basically. That was a beautiful rocket by Worley.
Gain of 24, and the Volunteers hustle to the line. 3 minutes to go. at a 14-point deficit.
Oh, nice play at the end of that one.
Jason Kroom, who is wearing number 18, there's another 18 on this team, stock still, but he just plays special teams.
Yeah, Jalen Watkins made a wonderful play. Remember, in college football, you don't have to turn back and look for the ball. And Watkins played the hands of the receivers, and I think if he hadn't made that play, that would have been a touchdown. It's Griffin time here for Florida, I'll tell you.
You know, the game was a sellout, but even when the game kicked off at 3:30, the far side, the upper 10 rows were empty, and even more so now. Every game at Florida has been sold out for quite some time. Well, that one's batted down at the line of scrimmage. And here's another third down. Damian Jacobs knocked this one down, number 4.
They picked up the last third down. And they got two more tries to pick up this one.
Here comes the blitz. Nice blitz pickup. Worley goes right. Up in the air. Tipped away. It was intended for Josh Smith. And there's the true freshman Hargraves.
And look how instinctually he played that play. A lot of pressure. He doesn't panic. He stays with his guy, turns around, goes up, and just bats the ball down. That's stuff that you cannot teach. I mean, yep. He, as I said, he came in with huge hype, and he's exceeded it.
So on 4th and 10, Tennessee obviously goes for it, trailing by 14. Four-man rush. Worley steps up, comes near side, overthrows his receiver, Pig Howard. Ball goes over on downs.
Let me start with Tennessee here. I think the Tennessee coaches will tell their players after this game, we've improved. I mean, what we did last week when, actually, Butch Jones used this word, we were embarrassed, okay? I don't think they have anything to be embarrassed about. Bad start. It was an embarrassing start, but they hung in this football game.
There was enough embarrassing for both teams in that first half. But they hung in and made a game out of it. They've used their last timeout. So barring something extraordinary, and they're already in the victory formation now, Florida's going to win for the 9th time in a row.
And I really believe it's been the same storyline in each one of these things I've done. The running game for Tennessee has not been able to produce enough to take the pressure off the quarterback for Tennessee. It's really been the game. Mm-hmm. Again, 66 yards. They just cannot find a way to run the ball against Florida.
And Tyler Murphy takes another knee. Well, Nathan Peterman, who is from nearby Jacksonville, a suburb of, and he was replaced after a really tough start by Worley, who comes in 10 of 21 for 149, a touchdown and an interception.
You know, I think back just as when we've done these games in the past, remember when Derek Dooley gave Matt Sims the opportunity to play in these big games against Alabama and LSU, and Matt didn't quite get it done?
Right.
Yeah, Matt's made an NFL team. You know, I mean, so sometimes you just got to hang in there, and I hope Nathan Peterman hangs in there for the rest of his career.
Peterman, a young man, as we said, from Fruit Cove, Florida. Grew up admiring a guy named Tebow, who played for this team. And a reminder, stay tuned for the Jeep postgame show on CBS Sports. We'll bring you up to date on all the mismatches in college football today.
I think the biggest question coming out of this game is, yes, we knew the elite defense for Florida, but can that man play enough quarterback for Florida to survive and get where they think they should go? That's the question from this game.
And, of course, the question to which we have not received an answer, what is the nature of Jess and the seriousness of Jeff Driscoll's injury? He came in with a sprained knee, but he went down with an injured right ankle, left the field in crutches. And you've heard Tracy bring us up to date with everything she had been able to learn. Now it's time for the play of the game presented by Napa Auto Parts. And with the call, here's Mick Huber of Florida.
Matt Jones, the running back. Here's Murphy. Looks to swing it out here to the right side. He's got the receiver out there to the catch. It's Pat on the far line, sideline at the 40. Quick attack at the 30. Down the sideline, the 20, the 10, the 5. Touchdown, Solomon Patton. Oh, my.
I kind of thought there'd be an oh, my at the end of that. I just had a feeling. And 26 seconds to go.
Nobody back. I really never understood this. Since there's nobody back, the punter just catches it and kicks it in a half a second.
Mm-hmm. Here's the punt. And it's out of bounds at the 47 with 16 seconds to go. Coming up tonight on CBS, back-to-back episodes of Mike and Molly, followed by NCIS Los Angeles, 48 hours, and that's all our primetime programming on America's most watched network. 16 seconds to go. Want to thank our guys in the booth with a special shout-out to David Moulton.
He's still here.
Yeah. We didn't throw him under the bus.
No. Just once. Just...
And the guys, he is to Gary's right, the guys to my left, our production crew up here. Butch Baird, spotter, Chuck Gardner, statistician, Katie McGuire, stage manager extraordinaire. And down in the truck, our group is led by our producer, Craig Silver, and our director, Steve Milton. Oh, dear.
Oh, geez.
Wow.
Careful.
That was Dante Fowler. Ooh.
That is, I think, the play that I predict becomes the most controversial in college football, when one of these days, one of these defensive linemen is going to run by the quarterback, swipe across their head, and get ejected for hitting, targeting the quarterback to the head.
This will be intercepted. Picked off by Marcus May, the freshman safety, and Worley is picked off for the second time. That's the last play of the game. Final score 31-17, 9 consecutive wins. Congratulations exchanged and commiserations in some case between Will Muschamp and Butch Jones. One of the stars of this game, defensive tackle Dominic E.